The Beyond Skyrim team has not released any new footage recently, so this month's update will be a discussion video on quest design and how Beyond Skyrim teams handle quests. We will then have our community Q&A from the Beyond Skyrim Discord and Reddit forums. And finally, you get to enjoy Dreamtime, so stick around till the end. In late March, the Beyond Skyrim team created a post talking about how quest design has changed over the years. The post says, "In the last decade, game writing quality and standards have improved a lot on Beyond Skyrim. Thanks to our ever-innovating team members, new editing departments and Arcane University teachers who work hard with writing students to think critically about the player's experience. One fun way to see this quality improvement is comparing outline silhouettes. You have quests drafted in 2019 before Anvil had barely any writing, and on the other side you have the same quest in 2024 as Anvil gets his final passes. So essentially you have two images here, a flowchart on how things were and how quest design is implemented now at Beyond Skyrim. Let's take a look at these flowcharts now. Alright, with my limited understanding of quest design, let's see what this is all about. So I guess the quest starts here, so I guess all of these are preconditions to the quest. So if these are satisfied, then the player can start the quest. And the player gets a choice to accept or decline, and then the quest continues here with an optional sidetrack here. I wonder what happens here after this. Do we come back, get back on track? I don't know. And then it's fairly linear after that. Look at that. It just goes this way, and then you have stuff to do here and stuff to do here. All these are quest stages, right? If you open the Bethesda creation kit, Skyrim creation kit, you can actually see the quest stages. So every quest stage has a number, and you complete one quest stage and then it moves on to the next quest stage, right? So sometimes you encounter bugs in quests where you're stuck up here, and so you use console commands to go back to this quest stage, and you do all sorts of stuff like that. So it's a very interesting system, the quest design system in the creation kit. What is this triangle? Okay, whatever. So you get here and then you complete the quest. This is I guess this is Bethesda style quest, fairly linear. Okay, all right now the new design. Quest started, okay. I'm assuming this is the precondition, and it says here, this is player action, objective, optional objective, okay. So you either do an optional objective or you get to the main objective, and then player does something. Optional objective, if you take the optional objective, you can directly get to the stage, I like it. Or you could, get into a different tangent, and where you have multiple choices, multiple ways of doing things, very cool, which will result in different experiences. So if you maybe choose this action, you directly get to this objective. If you choose this, then your experience will be completely different compared to people who choose this. You can either skip all of these optional objectives and directly get to the main next objective, or you go through all of these optional objectives for a different experience and ultimately you get here. So and then after that is fairly linear, I guess, with few branching choices, but I'm assuming this means that the quest fails. I mean, that's very important. Quests have to fail, right? Like what we see in Morrowind and the older games. In Skyrim, unfortunately, quests don't fail, and they've taken it to a completely new level in Starfield, where all the NPCs are essential and quests can't fail. I don't understand that, right? Why can't quests fail? It should not always be about the player's success. So yeah, there are more objectives here, and then you move on to the next. It's fairly linear from here. More objectives and more player actions. You have this objective here, which can enable you to do few more things, but then you don't get to this objective. So there's no arrow pointing this way. Okay, whatever, I don't understand this. Anyway, so, and then you have the quest completion. This is a very complex design. If you play the quest multiple times. You'll have different ways of doing things. So talking about quest design and looking at those flowcharts, I suddenly remembered this amazing quest from Fallout 1. If you played Fallout 1, you go to Shady Sands and you speak to Aradesh, right? Tandy is the daughter of Aradesh, and you actually have to go and rescue her from the raiders. This looks fairly simple, but then what I liked about this quest is there are multiple ways of doing things. You can go all guns blazing and try to rescue her, okay? At a low level, that is impossible. And then Gaal is the leader of the Great Khans, and the Great Khans are the faction we meet in New Vegas 2. You can challenge him and fight him in unarmed combat, and then rescue her. Or you could purchase her from Gaal, pay money, okay? Or you could intimidate Gaal with 45% speech check required. Or you could use a stealth approach and quietly kill the two guards at the rear of the building and then pick the lock on Tandy's cell. If you have a high luck stat and if wearing a leather armor, then Gaal assumes that you're his father. And he will comply with whatever you say, and then you can rescue Tandy in a peaceful manner. It's pretty interesting that the developers put an effort to actually give the players this option. This is a classic example of a quest that enables a player to achieve an objective in a variety of different ways. So this quest immediately popped into my mind when I was going through the flowchart, so I thought we'll talk about it. The Beyond Skyrim team asked these questions about quest design. When do you feel complexity goes too far? What's the threshold of simplicity a story should ground itself in? I have a limited understanding of quest design, nor am I a writer or a questing connoisseur. I don't play Elder Scrolls games for stories or mind-blowing quests. I play them for the lore, the characters, the feeling, the small stories, the exploration, and the game mechanics. But many of you love doing quests, and I would love to get your perspective on these questions. How complex is too complex? Do write your ideas in the comments below. My suggestion to the Beyond Skyrim team is to design quests that don't do a lot of hand-holding. The quest giver should give you the problem and not the solution. A fetch quest should not give you the exact location or the dungeon name. Some hints about the location may be provided, which may lead the player to speak to NPCs or find some notes or messages or find some trails. These extra steps would enable the player to zero in on the location and ultimately find the item. This kind of a design would elevate fetch quests and make it more rewarding for the player, in my honest opinion. Also, the journal should offer clues and list objectives that must be achieved and not point to direct solutions. I am certain Bethesda won't change their quest design philosophy, but the Beyond Skyrim teams can surely create much more rewarding fetch quests. To get another perspective on this, I asked Spook from our Discord. He has played all the Elder Scrolls games, and many of you know him from our Sunday Daggerfall series, and he had this to say. Highlight player and character decision making and not generalizing every quest for every possible character. If you can't talk to someone because your character is stupid or belligerent, you don't get to pass the speech check just because whoever was scripting the quest was under the mandate to let everyone complete the quest. Likewise, don't make it so that anyone that hasn't maxed out speech finds things completely inaccessible or harder for no reason. First, it was a problem in Fallout 3 with the stupid luck-based checks that meant anyone can pass anything, and then New Vegas had the complete opposite problem with speed checks completely trivializing or skipping quest lines entirely for no good reason. Just have multiple solutions to situations where possible, so that some quests are easier for others based on the character doing them, but don't fall into the trap of having god stats that mean one type of character is better suited to the majority of quest resolutions, because as we see in Skyrim, this just leads to the stealth archer trap. Excellent points by Spook as usual, and yeah, so I would love to read your comments too on quest design and what would you like Beyond Skyrim teams to focus on. Finally, I wanted to showcase how the Beyond Skyrim team places a huge emphasis on writing. All the quests from the team are written by a competent writing team. The writers in Beyond Skyrim team not only focus on lore world building, but they also create a document for every quest. This document outlines the backstory, the preconditions, all the NPC dialogues, the player response choices, and more. As you can see, the document is extremely detailed, so quest implementers using the creation kit can focus on implementation rather than worrying about writing. The document you're viewing is an example of a side quest in the Bruma release. As you can see, everything is specced out for the implementer in detail. If you want to be a quest designer or a writer, you have to get a good grip on quest design, which I think of as a bridge between story design and actual gameplay. Once you understand quest design, you can easily create such documents. I've spoken to some QA people from Beyond Skyrim Cyrodiil team, and they say that the writing is top-notch, which is not surprising, as the quest design in Beyond Skyrim Bruma was praised by many. If you look at the credits page of Beyond Skyrim Bruma, you'll see many writers here. Compare this to Starfield, where there was only one writer credited. I'm very excited for these Beyond Skyrim releases. The quests are going to be super fun. Also, if you love writing or love the idea of creating quests, do join the Arcane University Discord, where you can learn quest design. I did join the Arcane University and I was very interested to be a quest implementer, but I even spent some time doing some sample quests. I would love to be part of the Beyond Skyrim team. It would be such a beautiful creative outlet for me, but my job and the work on this channel makes that difficult. Maybe someday in the coming years. Question about Atmora. Will you be able to, say, establish your own player house or base? I get the continent is empty and inhospitable, but as a hoarder crafter player, I will definitely seek means to establish myself, at least to produce potions, improve and craft gear, and store what is found as loot.
You'll have the expedition's camp as a base of operations, but there will be no player homes, as you won't be staying in Atmora permanently.
In the future, once the projects are finalized, will you be able to travel between provinces? Or will they be separate from the player standpoint and only be enterable from Skyrim?
Yes, there's a clever setup for traveling between provinces without the need of a compatibility patch. There'll be border passes as well as cross-province ship travel to important ports.
As you know, the Creation Club has a creation which enables players to visit Riele, an elite ruin in the Jeral Mountains. The problem is Beyond Skyrim Bruma also adds Riele as a playable and in fact enables the player to visit it twice. So my question is, since the Creation Club Riele is heavily tied to the Creation's questline and disabling it would lock out the content, has there been any idea to merge both the Rieles?
For Cyrodiil, we'll do a post-release creation patch that will rename all instances of the Creation Riele to Solariel and say it's a different ruin.
Question for the Iliac Bay team, do you already have the Direni style of ruins, items, buildings, etc.?
Not yet. Nailing down a design for Direni stuff has been a lot of back and forth over the years, since it'll be reflected on the Adamantine Tower and be a big part of the high rock aesthetic. I know we generally don't want to emulate Skyrim home of the Nord style. I've been pushing for a chrome elven kind of thing, but we will see once the actual visual artists get a consensus. Yeah, Direni stuff is a ways off. I want them to be quite classically elven-looking, but with some distinct gothic elements thrown in.
Can you share some information on joinable factions in Beyond Skyrim Morrowind?
Morrowind would have the Temple, Morag Tong, and Tir Rawada as its currently planned joinable side factions, alongside a choice between one of the five great houses to join for that quest line. Tir Rawada being a Dunmer crime syndicate, kinda like the Kamona Tong of the Third Era. There's some non-joinable side factions that would have some side quest content, and perhaps some services too. In the New North, that'd be the Imperial Archaeological Society.
I was just talking to Astrid, and she said that the Dark Brotherhood crypt in Bruma was destroyed as a result of the ongoing war with the Thalmor. Is that going to be the prevalent thing in Beyond Skyrim Cyrodiil?
We know that in 4E175, the Great War ends with the White Gold Concordat. All we know about Bruma's Sanctuary is that it's gone. Reveal had a riot that resulted in the death of the Listener and the destruction of the crypt. It's unknown what happened to the Bruma Dark Brotherhood place.
The only active Dark Brotherhood sanctuary at the start of Elder Scrolls V would be the one in Skyrim, canonically speaking. but other places might have equivalent factions more tied to the local cultures, like the Morag Tong and Morrowind. There's a resistance faction in Cyrodiil, which would fill the assassin role somewhat too. Not every province nation has direct equivalents for assassins, thieves, mages, and fighters mercenaries. Sometimes it can be saved for something else.
Will the Somerset Islands get a Beyond Skyrim project? There's a lot of potential content in the Somerset Islands, and it is a land that has never got its own game. So many people will be curious to see what is in that province.
If a team wishes to make Somerset and has decent progress, we'll consider making them part of Beyond Skyrim. But we won't set up a specific Somerset team, as that's not how we work.
After assassinating the Emperor in the Dark Brotherhood questline in Skyrim, would you still see the Emperor, or would he not be there in Beyond Skyrim Cyrodiil?
The main quest will revolve around who gets to be Emperor. The player will support a claimant of their choice. There will be a stage in Cyrodiil's quest where if you have not killed the Emperor in Skyrim, it will be done by someone else. If the player has started the Dark Brotherhood questline but not killed the Emperor, the player must first play the questline until they kill the Emperor, before the next quest in the Cyrodiil main questline becomes available. If the player already killed the Emperor or destroyed the Dark Brotherhood, then the questline continues as normal. In the latter case, some unaffiliated assassin will get the Emperor. If the player has not been abducted by Astrid yet, we will provide a warning to the player that continuing will lock the player out of the Skyrim questline. They can still kill Grelid for Aventus, but won't ever be kidnapped by Astrid.
Will we get spells from Elder Scrolls 3 in Beyond Skyrim Morrowind, like Levitate, Mark and Recall?
Some spells from the Elder Scrolls 3. The personal teleportation and levitation ones aren't currently planned, though, given Skyrim isn't really designed to support that kind of mobility. As in a level and quest design kind of thing mainly, where progression can be tied to elevation, or a quest might need you to be in a certain place at a certain time. At least, we don't plan on adding them directly, but feel free to pair third-party mods offering those kinds of spells with Beyond Skyrim if you want. And don't mind that. It could break some content depending on how it's used.
Oh, that's disappointing. I would have loved to have all the classic Morrowind spells in Beyond Skyrim Morrowind, but it looks like they're sticking to the lore and ensuring that levitation won't be used in the fourth era, or the team does not want to add those spells. But we have seen the Skywind team creating these amazing spells. So anyway, whatever works for the Beyond Skyrim Morrowind team, if this is easier option, then so be it. I mean, if I am playing Beyond Skyrim Morrowind, I will definitely add a levitation spell. I have to do it because I'm in Morrowind. So we can always use Creation Kit and add those spells. But it would have been great if these were bundled in. So we have come to the end of this month's Beyond Skyrim update video. Well, more of a discussion video than an update, I guess, but I hope you guys had a good time, and we still have dream time. Thank you so much for watching, and I shall see you again next month for another Beyond Skyrim update video. May the Divines watch over you.
Thank you.